Hi everyone! In this video, I will show you some tips and tricks I use to recreate my favorite Zelda game into the browser. For that, I use JavaScript, the programming language, and a WebGL library called Three.js. You don't have to be a professional programmer to watch this video. The idea is mostly to show you that with a little bit of time and some effort, nothing is impossible in programming. But before that, let me explain to you a little bit more about the story behind this project. Let's go! Alright, so some months ago, I tried to recreate one of my favorite Zelda games, Wind Waker, into the browser. I've been doing websites since more than 10 years now, and I used the skill I had in HTML, CSS, JavaScript, and mostly WebGL to make this project come to life. I even made a first YouTube video explaining why I did it. I didn't go into too much detail, but I explained how I made the ocean using what we call the Animate render texture, how to make toonish lighting style effects, and more. Of course, the code of this entire Zelda project is open source, and you can find it, all the links are in the description. So if you haven't seen it already, and you have time to watch it, just go for it. That's my best video, I think. Well, about that, the video didn't get as many views as expected, sadly. I got way less than two other tutorials I made about 3GS for some reason. But who cares? Most of the people who watched it seemed to really love it. I got a lot of great comments and it made me very happy. So thank you again for all your support. Among all these comments, one particularly triggered my attention. We were talking about what we could add to this project to make it better, and the message was, one easy thing maybe, also add the crane interaction, and default it to find chest, no chest, and triforce piece? Adding a quest to the game? Why not? Challenge accepted. Let me explain a little bit. So at some point in the real Zelda game, you have a pretty long quest that consists of finding all the shards, pieces, of the Triforce. They are hidden in random places in the ocean. And I found this idea really cool because it doesn't require any work on the lens. And since I built everything related to the oceans, it was easier for me. On top of that, it is also adding a purpose to the explore part. That's perfect. So I've got this idea of hiding three treasures into the oceans. And in this video, I will show you 4 tips and tricks I used to add this new quest into the game. The first step is adding bones to an object in Blender to then use it into 3GS. To make this treasure quest work, the first thing I had to do was to add the crane. That way, Link could look for sunken treasures in this ocean. Fortunately for me, the model I had from the boat was already including it. But the rope was missing. Okay, so making a rope shouldn't be too hard, right? I mean, it is just a straight cylinder because in the game, the rope is always stretched by the weight of the hook. So I just made a simple cylinder in Blender and added it to the scene. Cool, so all of the elements were there, but they were moving independently. Like I couldn't just move the crane to move the hook and the rope together. So to attach the rope between the crane and the hook, and also to animate it later, I needed to use what we call bones in Blender. Bones can be used to create what we call an armature. You can think of it like a skeleton of our character, where each bones influence a certain area of the mesh around him. And each bones are connected to each other. That way, if I move the arm of a character, for example, the hand will follow the movement. I got lucky again, because the crane already had its own armature. So I needed to add a new bone for the rope and the hook. I did that using what we call bone parenting. In the mesh view, you can do it like so. Go to object mode, select the mesh you want to link to an armature, hold shift and select the armature. From there, switch to pose mode, select the bone you want to link to, and then press Ctrl P or Command P if you're on a Mac, and select bone. Set a bone as a parent of the object. And ta-da! The object is now linked to the armature. Everything was fine in Blender, bones were working good, but when I imported it into my code in 3GS, the hook were badly scaled and it was like 10 miles away. I was really lost. So one thing I learned when exporting bones to Three.js is avoid bone parenting in an already existing armature. It's better to recreate a new armature from scratch, or you can still use the bone parenting, but you'll have to manually update the initial position in Three.js. I was not really good at armature in Blender, so for this example, I just manually fixed it. I moved the hook position and scale using a GUI. As you can see, I was really struggling here. So, I do not recommend. Alright, so now I had the bones and the meshes positioned correctly, I could create my old crane animation really easily. Let's see how in the next chapter. Animating 3D objects in Three.js using Blender is actually pretty simple. We can do that using armatures and bones like we saw just before. To create an animation in Blender, first open the dope sheet view and select the action mode. Create a new action if you don't have one already. Then select your armature in object mode, switch to pose mode, and you can see here in blue all the bones that we can play with. Select all of them by pressing A, then press I to store the position, rotation and scale of all your bones at the beginning of the timeline. Move on to the timeline and rotate any bone you want. Press I again to save the state of it. Now, when pressing the spacebar, you can see your animation playing. It's simple as that. You can even use easing to get a smoother interpolation between keyframes by doing right click, easing mode, and choose the easing that you want. Then, when exporting as a GLTF, don't forget to check the animation settings so it can export all the keyframes. Now, going back into our Three.js code, if we log our exported GLTF object, we can see there is an animation array containing all of the keyframes. From there, we'll have to use a new instance of the animation mixer from Three.js by adding the mesh we want to animate. We can then create an action object using clip action that we can play and stop whenever we want. Don't forget to update the mixer every frame using the delta time or any specific value. And ta-da! Using this, we can have our animations playing in Three.js. Pretty easy, right? Going back to our chest quest, when Link finds the treasure, a small animation is playing. Link is looking deep into the sunken chest to find something, and then, with a big smile on his face, he just shows it to whoever is looking at him from the sky, I guess, a seagull maybe? Whatever. I had to recreate this animation from scratch, with the tricks I just showed you before. And to be honest, it was the hardest part for me, simply because I'm a web developer after all and not a 3D modeler. Anyway, after some time and a lot of effort, I came with this. Okay, it's not perfect, but that will do the job. I also included the music to make it feel more like in the real game. Now, let's move on to the next chapter. We have the animations when Link finds the treasure, but we need to place this treasure somewhere. In the original game, you can spot some light ring on the horizon going up to the sky. It had a really cool effect, attracting curious players. In terms of 3D, it's pretty simple, right? It's just a cylinder geometry. So I decided to make it from scratch. The tricky part is to have this glowing effect with patterns. For that, I needed to use what we called a custom shader. But what is it? And what are shaders, you may ask? Shaders are programs made to communicate directly with the GPU, aka the graphic card, which are very good for parallel computing. The name of the programming language for WebGL is GLSL. Shaders are divided in two types, the vertex shaders and the fragment shader. They are both essential to make this work. First, the vertex shader will be called for each vertices of our object. These are points in the 3D coordinates x, y, z. It will use these coordinates with the camera location to place them in the scene. So for a simple triangle, the vertex shader will be called 3 times. After being called, it will give these positions to the fragment shader, which will colorize this part, using each pixel of your screen. That way the triangle could be in any color we want, or with some gradient effect for example, and many more. Always keep in mind that absolutely everything displayed in a WebGL scene are made from shaders. Three.js is just making all the default shader code for us, so you don't have to worry about it. They are all in the default materials that Three.js gives you. And if you're curious, you can find the code of the shaders in the shader lib and shader chunk folder on their GitHub. It's a very complex language, but to me, it's essential to at least have an idea of what's going on, and that way understand why my object is displayed in my scene. So let's go back to our light ring. First, I created the shape in Three.js using a cylinder geometry. Then, I used the custom shader material to recreate the effect I wanted. For the vertex shader, I just used the default one, just taking the position of my object and displaying based on the camera position and the parameters. Then, in the fragment shader, I wanted to display a full white color, but with some random transparent parts. UVs will help me to draw correctly the colors into the cylinder. You can imagine them like we were folding a piece of paper to make a cylinder. I used a noise function and combined it to the X and Y axis of the UVs to display my random transparent parts. And voila! It looked pretty nice, but it was not glowing like in the original game. But luckily for us, there is a really convenient trick with 3GS that's almost magical. It has a blending effect built in, and we just need to add blending, additive blending, as an option of our shader material. Yes, it's simple as that. And here is the final result. Better, right? Now we can finally move on to our final chapter, collisions. In the first game I did, some people told me they were frustrated to not be able to go closer to the island. And I totally understand. Having these beautiful islands and not being able to see them closely into details seems a bit wasted. So I decided to improve that in this version 2. For that, I had to update the collision system so the player could go further. But what's a collision system? Well, to avoid the player to go through walls or any object of your game, you need to have a collision system. In 3GS, you can set up that using what we call a physics engine. And you can find really cool ones on the web, like Canon.js, Wamo.js, or if you're familiar with React and you're using React 3 Fiber, Rapier will do all the physics for you using React components. Pretty cool. These engines are really amazing, but they imply a lot of computation. And with all the elements already running in my Zelda game, it could drastically impact the performance and make computer burns. So I preferred avoiding that. Since I just wanted to prevent the player to go into certain areas, I could just do the test in 2D space using X and Y coordinates. I didn't care of height collisions because the user was always at the level at the sea. Cool, that's less computations, right? So I made my own 2D collision system using the coordinates of the player and any forbidden area close to him. I detected two types of shapes for collisions, circles and quadrilaterals. For circles, it's pretty easy. You just need to get the distance between the player position and the center of your object and compare this value to the radius of your circle. If the radius is bigger, that's a collision. So you need to stop the player movement. For quadrilaterals, which are polygons with four edges, it took me a bit of time. But after finding some math function on the web, I got it work. Yay! Now that I got my collision system running, I could create any circles and polygon I wanted to prevent the player to go through certain area. I did that in Blender for each island, as you can see here. It took me a little bit of time, but it wasn't hard at all and pretty fun to do. And here is how I made a more optimized 2D collision system. Of course, if you're making a much more complex game, I invite you to use the physics engines I mentioned earlier. But if the collisions just need to be in 2D with really simple shapes, you will save a huge amount of performance using this trick, even though it's not perfect. Alright, now that I show you the four tips and tricks, I think it's finally time to show you all the pieces together. Ready? Let's do it! And that's it for this video. I hope you guys liked it. If you haven't visited the website already, just go for it. The links are in the description. You can also get access to all of the code of this project because it's open source. I hope you guys liked this video, and if you did, please leave a like and subscribe to not miss any new tips. You can also support my channel on my Patreon to help me make more videos like this. It will also give you an access to all of my other JavaScript tutorials. Thank you again for watching this video, and see you next time!